and counseling education. My name is Kemba Duka. We'll be right back after the presentation. Doc, good morning. Good to see you.
Good morning.
I guess the level 200 students are ready for this morning's lecture. Oh,
thank you. Good morning, my wonderful listeners. And then those who will be watching live from Facebook, you are also welcome. I'm Teresa Emchi from the Department of Foundations. And today we are going to look at one of our courses, which is Introduction to Guidance and Counseling. And our course code is EDC 351. And today our topic is guidance services. And under the guidance services, we have what we call the follow-up service. So the main topic is the follow-up service, but it is under the guidance services. So I will start straight away because of time, because by 7:30 I'm having another lecture, so I have to leave you. So please, you need to listen and then pay attention. And then you also have to call in. That's when the time is due. That's 0503923158. So to begin with, you must know what guidance services are. So we are saying that guidance services are professional help that are given to individuals or group of students. That's group of students who are having commonly reoccurring problems. That's as a teacher, you'll be teaching, and maybe in your school, for let's say within a year, you may see that the females, they are getting pregnant. Let's say a school of about let's say female population of let's say 40, and then about 10 of them getting pregnant within a year. So you see that is something that is occurring. And it's not only the year that you spend there, about 2-3 years, it is something that is reoccurring. So this one, you need to come out with some services and the guidance so that you can help these students. And all that we are saying, that these services are done by professionals. So as we are talking about professionals, when we started with guidance and counseling, we talked about the levels of counseling. That's people who can take us through counseling. We came out with the informal counseling, where our aunties, our uncles, our brothers, our grandpas, significant others in the society, that's chiefs and other people, can help us through this guidance counseling. And then we also came across people who have studied in some areas, and then they can also help us in counseling. So they are called the non-specialist counselors. So for them, they have a training in an area, although it's not counseling, but they can help in counseling us. That's their form of counseling is like a way of giving advice to us. So the informal counseling and then the non-specialist counseling, they all have a way of giving advice to us. But the professional counselors, they are those that have been trained. They are the qualified people who are supposed to give counseling. Because of this, they have been what? Licensed. So if you are licensed, then it means you qualified to give counseling service. But since you are teachers, you are pegged at the non-specialist counselors. So here you are also, that's why we are doing this guidance and counseling, so that you have an area of it, so that when you go out there, you can also help your students with all these problems. So with this, we have various services under the guidance service. We have the appraisal service, we have the consultation service, we have information service, counseling service, follow-up service, orientation service, placement service, referral service, and even we also have the evaluation service. And the evaluation service is where you judge the effectiveness of your programs that you have with your students. So we are now moving on to the actual topic for today, which is the follow-up service. And it always interests me. With follow-up service, I always situate it to, let's say, doing evangelism. All the churches, Catholics, Methodists, Pentecostals, whatever, we all do evangelism. But there is this particular group of people, when they do evangelism, they try to do follow-up. And these are the Jehovah's Witness group of people. no matter the situation, they will come to you if you give them the time every day. If you don't take care every day, they will be visiting you. So they do follow up services on the evangelism that they've what done with you. So the follow up service too is the same thing. This is where we try as much as possible to follow our students, the students that we've helped, the students that we do remedial counseling with, the students that have been promoted to a different class, the students that have been transferred from where they are to another town or village or whatever. We need to do follow-up service to these people so that we find out whether they are actually progressing. Even it's not them alone, even the dropouts, we need to do follow-up for them. Why the dropouts? What is causing that? And how are they feeling as they've been what drop out? So we need to do follow-up service for all these group of people. So we are saying here that follow-up service involves procedures in which the counselor finds out how individuals are progressing after they've gone through some other guidance services. So somebody has come for counseling service. If there is the need to do follow-up, please, you have to do follow-up and then find out how the person is progressing. So we also have other services that calls for follow-up service. And these services are counseling service, placement service, orientation service, and then referral service. Referral is just referring somebody to another specialist. Maybe the problem is beyond you, so you have to refer that person. If a counselor you refer, please, that doesn't mean you are not competent. You are a competent person. So as a teacher, when you go out there and then there are children, their problems are beyond you, please do refer them to the right quarters so that they can get help from them. So when there is referral service, maybe somebody came for counseling with maybe an eye or ear problem. I'm not a specialist in that area, so I can't say that I'm a counselor, I'm Madam Know-All, so I have to treat that person. It can't be possible. So here I have to refer the person to the ear and then eye whatever or nose specialist so that they can treat the person better than me. So when you do such referral service, you need to do follow up and then find out the progress of that particular child. So we talk about these guidance services that also needs what follow up, especially when counseling service is done, when placement service, we are not saying that we are giving them jobs, but even in your class, as you've repeated somebody, you've done placement service. As you've been what promoted, you've done what placement service. So we need to be careful when our students are being promoted. You are teaching in SHS 1, they've all been promoted to SHS 2. You can do follow-up service and then find out what is actually going on there. Find out their progress. You repeated somebody in a class, you are still with that person, you still need to do what follow-up. Find out how the person is progressing. So follow-up simply means we just try to find out how our clients or our students are faring. Now let's move on to the purpose of follow-up service. The main purpose is gathering information about students who have left school. So we need to gather information about students who have left school, then also helping social agencies and schools to deal with the problem of youth more appropriately. So whatever problem that our youth are having, we should try as much as possible to do this follow-up service so that we can help them. Apart from the purpose, we also have what we call the characteristics of follow-up service. So with this follow-up service, we are saying that one of the characteristics is continuous. Thus, if it is continuous, then it means it's also like a process as guidance or counseling. So it's a process. But the fact that we are saying it's a process doesn't mean we should do it till the end of the person's life. No. If that happens, then it means we are even spoon feeding that person. So we should do it in such a way that a time may come where there will be termination, where you can end the follow-up service. So you may be following up, and then when you find out that the person is now fixed into what he or she is capable of doing, this is where we need to end our termination. So the fact that we are saying that it is having the characteristics of continuity doesn't mean that we should continue till the end of life. No, there should be termination. If we find out that the person is not capable of doing what is expected of him or her, then we end the follow-up service. Then the second one, we are also considering the fact that it includes all students. Why are we saying it includes all students? It's not for only those who have problems and then have come for counseling. All students are involved. Even if we have orientation, we need to do follow-up, whether it has really worked with you or not. So it's for all students. It doesn't matter those in school, those who have finished school, those even dropouts, students who have even dropped out, we need to do follow-up service for them. Those who have left the school, those who have been transferred, we need to do follow-up service for them. Then we also look at another characteristic, which is begin before the student leaves what school. We have to bear in mind, follow-up service should begin in the school before the child will leave that particular school. Since they have problems and then we are those helping them, we need to do follow-up so that when the child leaves the school, at least you can continue with the follow-up service. And then also, each class is followed for at least 5 years. So promotional issues, you need to follow the class and then find out their states. Those who have been repeated, they are very, very important. Those who have been repeated, we need to do follow-up service and then find out how they are progressing. How they are progressing. So it's very, very important to look at all these things. And then we need to plan to serve the needs of both individuals and then the school. So we need to plan this follow-up service in such a way that all individuals, the needs of the individuals, the needs of what the school will be properly done, so that there won't be much problems in the schools again. These are the characteristics of follow-up service. Then we look at the types of follow-up service. We have so many types, but we will consider only four here because we are in the school setting. So the first one is the in-school follow-up. In-school follow-up. So you are with your students. This is where some of them will come for counseling, and then some orientation services, placement services, and so on and so forth. So with all these people who are in the school with you, you need to do follow-up service with them. So while they are in school, they remain in the school, and then you should try as much as possible to help them with these services because they've gone through some services with you and then they need this kind of follow-up service. We also have those who are out of school. The fact that they are out of school doesn't mean that we should leave them like that. Some of them, we even see them as teachers and then we laugh at them. Oh, he was in school and then look at her. She's now selling pure water, he's now selling this, he's now selling that. We need to be careful about that. We need to do a little bit follow-up and then find out the reason why that child left school and then now selling pure water or selling ice kinky or whatever. So we need to look at all these things. So we need to look at those in school, that's the first type. Then out of school, we need also to look at those people. Then the third group of people that we need to look at is the students who are receiving remedial help. If students are receiving remedial help from you, you need to do a follow-up. As a teacher, students will come to you, confide in you, they have some trust in you. So they will tell you their problems. So if such information is given to you and then you try solving it, you need to do a follow-up service to find out how the problem is being solved and then how best that child is what progressing. So here, the way the child will progress is what we are talking about here. It's very, very important in our services, which is the follow-up service. Then we also have students who has been transferred from one school to the other school. There are so many teachers, when their students even transferring from one school to another school, let's say even they finished JHS and they've moved on to the senior high school, these people too, we need to do follow-up service. And I remember my son JHS, even the school that he chose, it was chosen by a teacher, not me as a parent. So when he entered that particular school, it was like every day they will call and then find out how the child is progressing. So I was like, wow, they are doing full of what? Follow-up service. Even after his SHS and then to the university, the same thing. They would just call, find out how that child is what? Progressing. So it's like when you do this, even the parent will know that as teachers, we do what? Care. And as we are doing this also, we should avoid discrimination. It's not that we will follow up to only students who are good. No. Even those who are weak, we need to follow up. And even for them to know that the teachers are following up, although they are weak, it will even motivate them to do something for their teachers. Oh, sir is always calling mommy, daddy to find out how I'm progressing. Hey, this one I have to learn for sale. You may see that these children will be motivated and then they will keep on learning. So we need to do that. So with the types of follow-up service, we have the in-school follow-up service. We also have the out-of-school follow-up service. We also have those who are receiving remedials, that's counseling services and other things. We need to do follow-up service for them. And then students who have been transferred from one school or to another school. Some of them too, they are transferred not because they've moved on to maybe a higher level, but because of the nature of the work of their parents. So maybe the parents will be in Winneba, then transfer will come in, especially the police service. You may see that transfer within just a year, they can be transferred twice. So you may see the students also being moving with them. So they all need this kind of follow-up service, so that at least they will know that we also care about them. So we also move on to the importance of follow-up service. So with the importance, we are saying that it enables the students as well as teachers and then parents to realize the problems ahead. If you don't do follow-up service, some of the parents, they are with their children, but they don't know actually what is happening to them. They don't know. So with the follow-up service, it will help the parents, it will help teachers, and even that child, him or herself, to know the problem ahead and then how best we can solve this problem. So when such things come, the teacher becoming aware, the parents becoming aware, the student, him or herself becoming aware, this is where we also consider another service as the consultation service. So this is where we can consult and then see how best, if the teacher, the parent, and then the student, him or herself, we come together, how best we can solve that problem. So we are saying that follow-up service enables the students as well as what teachers and then parents to realize the problem ahead and then how best they can solve this particular problem. Then another point is that it determines progress being made by clients or students who have received remedial treatment. That's, you've come for counseling, the problem is there, we are trying to solve the problem. Without follow-up service, I don't know whether the solution given, whether the strategies given, whether you are what doing the right strategies or not. So this one, I have to come out with follow-up service so that at least I will know and then find out whether the services rendered to you is usually useful to you and then even how you are applying all these strategies, and then how they are helping you. We said one of the characteristics is continuity, but I said at the end of it, there should be what? Termination. The fact that we are saying it's very important to follow up, that doesn't mean we should follow up to the end of that individual, that to the end that the person would die. No, then it means we've not done any good thing to the person. We should follow up to some extent and then allow the person to move freely in life. So this is also one of what the importance of follow-up service. Then it helps assess educational progress of students. If we do follow-up service well, we may see that it will even motivate the students, and then their progress in education will be elevated. But at times we don't do it well. At times we even see them and then insult them. You are big-headed, you are this, you are that, and so on and so forth. Even in class, somebody who is repeated, and then we are trying to help that person. This is where the person will score zero, and the teacher will have the guts to draw the zero, and then add some ears, nose, mouth to it. And then it's like the teacher is demoralizing that particular child. And if care is not taken, you may see that that child will stop schooling, because the person has been what? Repeated. There are students who have been repeated maybe 3 or 4 times in the same class. We need to do follow-up service to help these children. So with all these, it will help us in assessing our educational background of our students. Then it also enables counselors to know their progress and how well students are faring, both in and out of school. So as a counselor, as a teacher, so now you are the non-specialist, you are learning this course so that when you go out there, you can help our students. It's not that you are going out there to teach guidance and counselors as I'm teaching here. You are going out there to use the skills to help the students out there. So with this, you need to find out, you've done something. How is it progressing? How is it helping that particular child that you've helped? So all remedial services that you've been given, all class exercises, whatnot. That's why we've been doing corrections in school. That's when they get something wrong, they have to do correction. It's what? Follow up. So you are following up to see whether they've understood what they had wrong now. So we need to consider all these things and then see how best we can help our students. Then the last one, we are saying that it helps schools to appraise their programs. And it's very, very true. It helps you to appraise their program. From the beginning, I use an example of where these teenage girls will be getting pregnant in schools, and then you need to follow up. The follow-up service, you may do these guidance services. And then one of them is the information service. So this is where you plan by the school and then say that, oh, we can give them a talk on teenage pregnancy. So if such a talk is given, and then at the end, maybe every year, 7 of them will get pregnant. But when the talk was given, it was reduced, let's say 3. Then it means there is what, an improvement. Then maybe the next year it was also done, and then finally only 1 person got pregnant. So this one, the school can incorporate this information service in their program. And then when there is this Valentine's Day, what's not, before that, they can use it as a program. So this is a program that we are all going to work on. We are going to talk about teenage pregnancy. We are going to talk about what, drug abuse, and so on and so forth. Some of the students, though they are in JHS, some even primary, as for SHS, no way. And you are going out there to teach these children. So we need to integrate some of these services in our school programs so that we can give this information to the students. Because when we plan well, they will know the meaning, they will know the causes, they will know the effect, even on them themselves. So most of them will desist from it. So one of the importance, which is the last one, we are saying that it helps schools to appraise their programs, so be it information service on teenage pregnancy, substance abuse, anything at all that will help these young ones, help these young girls. We can try as much as possible to integrate it in our school program so that we can have a day for such events in the school, and it will really help the students. Now we are moving on to the role of the counselor in the follow-up service. This one we are talking about professional counselors, but as you are going out there, you are not professional counselors. You are non-specialist counselors. You've learned guidance and counseling, but not into detail as someone who is a professional does. So what is your role as you are going out there? This one is for counselors, but since we are also non-specialists as our level, we must also do the same. You must also do the same. But if it is above us, please, we have guidance coordinators at the regional offices, at the district offices, so we can visit them and then find out how best they can also help us. Though you are not a counselor, you can talk with your headmaster. You can go to the office, talk to the guidance coordinator over there, and then see how best you can come up with what set programs in your schools. So with the counselor, that's the role that the counselor should play, or you as a teacher, the first one is that you need to collect data. So what is the problem about? You must know the problem. And without data, you may not know. You can't just get up and say, this is the problem of my student. You must get some evidence to show that this is the problem of your student. So here, you need to collect data about the individual through the use of interview, case history, and then we can also use observation. As teachers, we need to do a lot of observation. Even some of these students, they will come to school, it's like they are quiet, but that's not their nature. So this is where you can approach them, find out, today you are quiet. What is happening? It's just true observation. You observe and then you are able to find out those problems. So what we are saying is that you need to collect data to back your evidence that the children are having such and such and such a problem, and then you need to help them. So as a teacher, when you go out there, you need to at least be observant. You can also conduct few interviews with them and then find out their problems. Even their history, even the cumulative record book. Once a while, you can just open these books and then see how best you can just notice some few things about your students. It's very, very important. Although we'll talk about the problems as well, time is not on our side, but still we need to do all these things as teachers. Then maintaining contact with school leavers, that's both dropouts and then graduates, and try to assess in their after school adjustment. So we need to get their contact as well, their contact, so that when they go out there, we should try as much as possible to reach them and then find out how they are faring. It's not that we need to do follow-up. So if somebody is, let's say, the northern part of Ghana, then you just travel all the way from your village to that particular place. No, we are not saying that. You can reach the person on what, phone? If not at all, you can even liaise with the counselor over there so that that counselor will do the follow-up for you. But in doing that, you should also try as much as possible to be in line with what the counselor, so that whatever that will be going on, you will also become aware of such things. Then also monitoring individuals' adjustment and achievement of former learners. And it's very, very important. And this one is not about the teachers alone. Parents also, we need to do some follow-ups and then find out how our children are adjusting to situations, especially those in schools, those in the universities. If your child is in the university, you need to try as much as possible. This is not for counselors alone. It's for all parents. We need to call them, find out, tell them. the importance of this adjustment in life. So all that we've been doing, you call them, so how far? My daughter would just call me mama. At the moment that you say mama, then I know there is problem. Mama, I can't cope with my roommate again. But as I'm calling you, what you will tell me is I shall adjust. Then I will say adjustment. Then the problem is solved. Because she is aware that she should what? Adjust. It's not all the things that you will get freely like that. You need to adjust to situations. You need to adjust. Even roommates, it's a problem. It's a problem. So you need to what? Adjust. So all these students who are leaving us, we need to get their contacts and then try as much as possible to help them so that they can adjust to their new environment. If it is work that they are doing, we need to help them so that they can adjust to the work that they are doing. If it is a new school, they have to, we must help them to adjust to that particular new school, especially when they are going to from JHS to SHS and then SHS to the universities. We need to, this one, teachers are involved, counselors are involved, and then parents are also involved. So we have a lot to do with our students as well as our own children. Then also, we are saying that we should use information and data accruing from follow-up service for the possible revision and then enlargement of the school educational work program. What do we mean by this? It's very, very important. Data accruing is something that we need to do. We can't just come out and then say that this is the problem whilst we don't have evidence. I think I've said this. So we need to accrue data. We need to get information. We need to get evidence so that we can help out all these things. Then the last one, we need to help individuals plan. We need to help them obtain. We need to help them derive maximum benefits from educational, social, vocational, and other kinds of experience to discover and develop their potentials. So how our students can develop their potentials educationally, socially, and then vocationally. As a counselor, we need to do that. So it's very, very, very important. So our last aspect that we are going to look at is the problems of follow-up. But before then, I'm calling the numbers again. 0503, if you have any question, if you have any contribution, you can call 050-392-3158. You can also WhatsApp, you can also text through the same line, 050-392-3158. So we are moving on to the problems of follow-up service. As I was speaking, I was like, you need to follow. You need to follow. Follow them. Contact them. Their numbers. You can even travel to them and so on and so forth. So the traveling, that costs whose credit? So the major problem that we have here is lack of financial support. You'll be doing all these things, but you will not be given any allowance for all this. But our job is to do no harm. So we are not harming anybody. We try to what? Put everybody in a good stand. So here, though there is what? Lack of financial support, but willingly, empathically, we can do this honestly. Then another problem is lack of adequate staff. Maybe I want to travel and then see, follow up what this particular child is doing for me. But because of inadequate staff, I can't leave my class and then just go and then be doing follow up service. So that one too becomes a problem. And then poor response from former students. There was this student that I was following up. And looking at things, it was like the student was feeling like, madam is worrying me. Madam is worrying me. So at times, even when you call, the response is not all that good. So if you don't take care you will stop there, you will end there, and this is not the right thing to do. Although you may get this bad response, you should also try as much as possible to be positive with them. So we need to be careful about that. We will get the poor response, but still, that shouldn't undermine us. We need to do follow-up service. And then poor communication network. At times too, you may try as much as possible to at least communicate with these students, but because of the network system, it becomes very difficult to reach these students. Maybe their area too, when you want to travel there, it's like you can't go because the road network is also not good. So with the problems, we've looked at lack of financial support, lack of adequate staff, poor response from former students, and then poor communication network, as well as poor road networks. So in all, it's almost 7:30. What we've done, in a nutshell, we've talked about what guidance services are, the various services, we've mentioned them. We have a lot, but today we only talked about one, which is a follow-up service. And we've also been able to talk about what follow-up service is, then the purpose of follow-up service. We also look at the characteristics of follow-up service, and then the types of follow-up service that we need to consider. We also look at the importance of follow-up service, and then the role of a counselor or teacher in the follow-up service. And then lastly, we also look at the problems of follow-up services. So we've gotten some SMS messages here, and it reads, good morning. Please, I would like you to throw more light on the formation in terms of dealing with special students, because some of these students need to be, I can't see this word, need to be guided, for almost the rest of their life. This is from Collins Appiah, Integrated Science Department. Collins, thank you so much. We need to guide these people, as you've rightly said. So we need to do a lot of follow-up. With the one of the characteristics, I think I mentioned that it is continuous, that there should be continuity. If you find out that the person is okay, let me use okay, the person is now right, the person is now having the ability, the capability, the potential to be him or herself, then you can terminate the follow-up service. But if not, as you are suggesting, that special students, then we need to do follow-up service continuously. But one thing that you must know, Collins, is that for even the special students, they can even cope more than even those of us who are not special. Yes, at times you may try to guide them, and it's like you are worrying them. But if you think that the person is in good position, the person has gotten the capabilities, the potentialities to be on his or her own, then we need to terminate the follow-up service. But if not, then the continuity comes in. Thank you very much, Collins. So you can call in 0503923158.
Hello, madam, good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, my name is Christian.
Your name, please?
My name is Christian Okoku from Ministry Department.
Okay, Christian.
I would like to find out if all certified counselors being fit for counseling.
All certified counselors
being fit for counseling.
Yes, I will say yes. But we have areas where we are specialized in. For instance, I'm specialized in marriage. So if somebody is coming for marriage counseling, I will be there for the person. Somebody is also specialized in digital counseling. That's these online counseling, Facebook counseling, and those kind of things. So if such person come to me, I will just refer. That was why I said, if you refer, it doesn't mean you are incompetent. You are competent. That's why you refer the person. So if such people come in, I will refer that person to the one who is dealing with this online counseling. So that person also, since he or she is not specialized in marriage counseling, if there is anything, they will refer that person to me. So in all certified counselors can do proper counseling. But if you don't take care, and then maybe the person feeling reluctant to say that I'm not versed in this, so I'm referring you, then maybe it will be a problem. But I will say that all certified counselors, they can give you the right counseling. The right counseling. Thank you very much, Christian, from the history department. Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Good morning.
Good morning, sir. Your name? Please, can you turn the volume of your radio set?
Yeah.
Your name and location, please.
I'm from Mathematics Department.
All right.
Abdulrahman Sumala.
Yeah.
Madam, assuming the situation is too worse or the problem is difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just send the problem to the professional counselor before you do follow up?
Yes. Yes, that's why referral service is very, very important. So as you've referred the person, you are doing follow up with the referrer. So you can't just refer and then you stay out. That's why I said we have some services that demand follow up service, and I added the referral service. So counseling service demands it, placement service demands it, orientation service demands it, and then referral service also demands what? Follow up service. So you can't just give follow up and then that will be the end. A referral, and then that will be the end. You need to follow up and then find out the end. I hope it's clear. All right. Thank you, my mathematics students.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Please, this is
Your name again? Please, can you turn the volume of your radio set small for me?
Okay.
All right.
There are some things that we learn here, but when you get to serve, it means we are not practicing it. So I want to ask that, is this really happening on serve?
Yes, it happens. But what we are doing now is we are teaching you. Normally, we try to help you with all these things, but when you go out there, you don't do them. You don't practice them. But if you do it, it will help the students. It will help them. Most of us, it depends on the individual teacher, but it's something that you need to do. If only you have these children at heart, you can even visit them. After closing, you can visit them. That's home, especially those who are not performing well. And then you can even observe the way that the things that they've been doing. I think when I was teaching at this JHS level, there was a girl who always came to school and then this girl will be sleeping. I have tried all means, go and stand at the back, run, do this, do that, this girl will be sleeping. So I said, what is happening? But the girl will not talk. So one day I just visited the house, not knowing they prepare wachi. So this girl, every day, the girl will sleep around, let's say 2 a.m. and then wakes up 4 a.m. And then even after school, the child will work and work and work and work till that 2 a.m. So when I found out that when the child is sleeping, I allow the child to sleep. So after sleeping, then I will help the child what with what length. But I don't think all teachers can do this unless you have them at heart. That's why we are teaching you this particular course. You are not going there to teach guidance and counseling on the board as I've been teaching you. No. But this is something that you need to practice with the students. Practice with the students. So when I talked to the parents, it was like the child is not their rare parents, but later on, they reduce the household chores for that particular girl. So these are some of the things we can visit. We can do that. Although it's not happening. It's not happening, let me say, life and color there. But we can go out there and then practice. But some teachers are also doing it. Some teachers are doing it. So we can do that. Thank you so much for calling. Hello.
Hello, madam.
Yes, sir.
Good morning. My name is Kumpang Mwani Godwin.
Godwin.
From Advancing Disciples.
All right.
Madam.
Yes, sir.
As the important of God and country, looking at it important, can we have guidance counseling offices at the SHS level or VHS level to be taking the students through guidance counseling so that some of the students need guidance counseling at that business level? And if they are not taken through that guidance counseling, it is it affects their academic papers and other.
Thank you very much. Normally what we are doing now is integrating the guidance and counseling in our teaching. So be it a science teacher, be it mathematics teacher, be it social studies teacher, be it a Fanti or any of the Ghanaian languages, we have to integrate the guidance and counseling in our teaching. In our teaching. Anything at all that we are teaching, we should integrate this guidance and counseling in it. But this is something that most of the teachers, they don't do. They don't do. That's why we are saying that all these things, you can just go out there, plan programs. You have finished with the UUW. You are finished. You are a graduate from UUW. So you can go out there, but you go out there with humility. Don't say that I'm the one who has just finished UUW, the fresh graduate, and we have to integrate guidance and counseling in our teaching. Just humble yourself. Talk to them in a nice way. They will help in a way. You can even come out with these guidance committees, and then you see the programs that you can draw out of these things and then integrate them in the school. Especially the Wednesdays that we use for worship is good. We can talk about, let's say, 10 minutes, 20 minutes about the word of God. Then the last 10 minutes, we can use it for something on guidance and counseling. Something even self-care, guidance and counseling. You are guiding them. You are guiding them. We can talk about these substance abuse, teenage pregnancies, a whole lot. Even this cyber crime. You can talk to them about them. And then even this betting, JHS level, primary school. Then you see them betting all over. They even stop school and then they are doing all these things. So we can't just make it as a subject where we can teach there, but we do integrate them in whatever that we are teaching, be it mathematics, be it English, be it social studies, any of the Ghanaian languages, you can still come out with all these guidance and counseling in our teaching. Thank you so much for calling.
Uh,
The first one reads, good morning, please. My name is Kando Helen, Social Studies Department, level 300. My question is, in order to meet a counselor, do you have to pay before meeting him or her? Thank you so much, Helen, for your question. But if it is outside University of Education, whenever, then you have to pay. But if it is UEW, please, you don't have to pay anything. So as we are also training you to go out there to practice these services, you are also not going to charge anybody. We are being paid by the government, and it is part of our work. So please, if you have any problem, just come to the counseling center. We are the central campus. Just when you enter the gate, just on your left, we are there. We are there. So we don't charge. There is no charging. There is no fee for you to pay before we will counsel you in University of Education, Winneba. We don't pay anything. So when you also go out there and then you are practicing those things, you don't need to collect anything from the students or charge them anything. Thank you so much, Helen. I hope your question has been answered. Then another one is by Raman, Mathematics Department. Assuming the situation is true to the extreme, or in the worst case, can you just send the problem to the professional counselor before you? I think the person called in with this question. Yeah, yes. And I think I've answered him that. Can you send the problem to the professional counselor before you start the follow-up service? Yes. You can refer the person. Referral is very, very important. So you can refer the person before you do what? The follow-up service. Since you've also referred the person, you can do the follow-up service with the consent of the person who is now handling that particular problem. So you can seek the consent, and then you will do that particular follow-up service with the students. Thank you so much. There is another SMS. Good morning, madam. Please, my question is about the characteristics of follow-up service, which is saying continuity. However, you said it should be terminated at some time. How would you know that now the person is okay and therefore follow-up should be terminated? Thank you. This is from Gideon Social Studies. Gideon, thank you very much for your question. As a counselor, you need to be observant. You need to be observant. The problem that the person came in with, you must know the problem. As you are doing the follow-up service, Gideon, you need to be very observant. You've come out with this counseling service. You've asked the person. In counseling, we don't solve problems for individuals. We help them to solve their problems. We help them to come out with what? The right decision making, and then the right choice. So as they come out with these things, you will see if you observe them critically. So through observation, you will know that the person is now okay. So you need to terminate your services with that particular person. You need to terminate your services with the person. So it is continuous. But we need to what? Terminate. Because if we don't terminate and then we continue like that, then it means that the counseling service provided was a cost 90 work, which is zero. At the end, we should have a goal to achieve. I'm sure from the beginning, objectives of guidance and counseling, we should have objective to achieve. So if you are not able to achieve the objective and then we will still be doing this follow-up service, then it means that our objective is not being achieved. So we need to achieve our objective. And this can be done through observation. Even through some questionnaires. The person can just fill some questionnaires for you, and then you will know that the person is now okay, in that the person can be on him or herself. Thank you so much, Gideon. The name is. Today I came for follow-up service, and you are also asking me appraisal service, and then why individual inventory. We are saying appraisal service is the same as what individual inventory, because we do talk about what the individual. We appraise the individual. When we are collecting data, we don't collect data together. We just collect the data from one person, because the person is having that particular word problem. Especially if you are doing individual counseling. If it is group, then fine. You can collect that data from the whole group. And even the group two, we can say they are individual because they deal with what? One common problem. One common problem. That's why we are saying that appraisal is the same as what? Individual inventory. Because the data that we will collect for whatever that we want to do, we are collecting it from each individual. Each individual. And even if it is a group, because I can't form a group whereby I will have people with study habit problems. I will have people with marital problem. I will have people with premarital problems. I will have people with... I can't manage the group. So if I'm forming a group, I come out with, those with what? Study problems. Even that one, I won't say study problem, because if I do that, people will not come. So I will say study habit group. I will have a lot of people there. So in the study habit, I can even what? Get so many groups out of what? That study what habit group. But at the end, we all have the same problem. We all have the same problem. So if it's, we are talking about menopausal women, they are all menopause. So at the end, we are all having what? We are one individual. We are one individual. So appraiser collecting data for people or person is the same as what? Individual what? Inventory. Because it's done. We just need the data from what? One person, so that we can analyze and then look for common tools that we can use to help that individual. Although today I did follow up service, but I'm sure I've been able to answer your question. Thank you so much. One feature of follow-up service is that it begins before the student leaves school, and in your submission you avert that the follow-up service also happens after school. I'm a little bit confused. Please throw more light on it. Thank you. Pepra, what I'm saying is that it starts from school. Why am I saying it starts from school? It starts from school because somebody may come for remedial counseling. The person is having a problem. The person comes in with that problem. And then you try helping the person to solve that particular problem. So here, the person is in school and you are helping that problem. So with the problem, after the counseling section, you need to do follow-up and then find out whether the problem has been what, solved or not. So in school, follow-up service. And then with the in-school, apart from counseling service, we can also use this placement where you've repeated somebody, you've promoted somebody. All these things you need to do follow-up service. Children who are not performing, you need to do follow-up service. And then find out, why is it that they are not performing? Why is it that they come to school always and then be sleeping? So you need to do follow-up. With that evidence that you have, you can just do follow-up, and then at the end, you will yield some results. Then the after-school follow-up service must also come in. We are not interested in only those in the schools, those who have completed, and even those who are what? Dropouts. We need to do follow-up. Why the dropouts? So how are you faring about the dropout? Some of them are just money issues. You can talk it over with your head and then see how best, maybe three teachers, four teachers, how best you can help such students to maybe, if nothing at all, they should be able to finish the GHS. So after school, we need to do follow-up and then find out. You can't just train students, GHS, and then that will be the end. Especially when you are posted to a community, you find yourself among that community. So there is this belongingness. So some of these children will just move to, if you are teaching SHS, they will move to the tertiary, and then that will be the end. After school, you need to do follow-up. And then the follow-up here, Dominic, I'm not saying that travel to where the person is. You can just pick a phone. If you have their contact, I think we talk about these things. Just call the person. Hey, how are you? Even the person listening to the voice of his or her teacher is like, wow. Hey, I have to learn how though. We motivate them. So how are things? You are now at the university. So how are things different from there? As you compare it with SHS. So what can you say? And so on and so forth. So after school too, we need to do follow-up. And even after school, it's not that we need to do follow-up for only those at the tertiary. Anybody at all that you think you need to do follow-up, we should do it. So after school is very, very important. In school is also very, very important. And then those who have come for remedial services, they are also very, very important to do follow-up. And then the dropouts, they are also very, very important. We need to do follow-up for all these people. So we need to do follow-up for in-school, out-school, remedial services, and then those dropouts. We need to do that. And even those on transfers, we need to do follow-up service on them. Thank you very much. I'm sure, Dominic, I've answered your question. Another question, please, madam. I don't think integrating guidance and counseling will be the best option in the basic and SHS level. I think what will be effective is making a subject on its own. Most teachers know the importance of this course, but are much interested in finishing the syllabus. From Emmanuel. Emma, I think we started with this and I was like integrating guidance and counseling. If you are to make it a subject, Emma, we can't start it here. We can start it here, but maybe as time goes on, we'll write a proposal and then see how best we can come out with this problem. But it's good. That's why in most of the secondary schools we have offices for these counselors. So they also have their programs that they go about in the school to help the students. It's only that most of the counselors in the schools also, they don't perform. That's why you don't see their actions. You don't see their action. That's why you are still insisting that we should make it a subject and then teach on the timetable that we have guidance and counseling. No, it's just that those there, they are not doing their work well. That's why you don't see them. Because some of them will complain they don't have offices. Others too, they don't have so many things. They will come out with so many problems. So many things. And then staff, I'm the counselor in the school, but I'm still teaching. So the load, the workload on them. So you don't see these things. That's the practicality of the guidance and counseling with these staffs over there. But actually, they have to go to the schools and then help the students with these guidance and counseling services in their schools so that at least they will also grow up with it. And then at the end, they will become important people in the country. So although it's a good idea, but I think we should try as much as possible to make it in such a way that those who have been posted as guidance coordinators. And at times you go to these offices, you won't even see the guidance coordinator over there. They don't do their work. We also have these social people there. They will not do the guidance aspects of it, but they will be collecting monies for directors' transfers. Then as for that one, they will come to the school. but they won't come to the school to fish out the needy students and then how best they can help them. No. So most of them, they are the offices. It's only that they are not performing. If they should have performed the way we wanted, it's not a matter of integrating it in the syllabus. But we can, at the end, achieve something out of it. So we'll look at that one too. So Ima, I think we'll look at that one and then see how best we can come out with this. Thank you so much. SMS, good morning, madam. My name is Ask Maxwell Abimbila. If I was not able to mention your name well, please forgive me. From the political science department, please, madam, my challenge is when counseling service moves beyond helping the students to make an informed choice in life to include financial assistance, what would the counselor do at this stage? Thank you so much, Maxwell. As a counselor, we have a lot of things to do. And our qualities, I'm sure you've done the qualities of a counselor. So as a counselor, you need to be empathetic. Yeah. So though you'll be helping these students with counseling service, and then it's like this financial assistance comes in. We've been doing it, but those that are within our means, we've been doing it willingly. That's at the end, we are not going to collect the money from any other source, but willingly we do it. But those beyond us, we try as much as possible to lay our hands on if you are in a school, you can report to the district director and then find out how they can also liaise with the, if it is municipal or district, how do we even call it? District, is it district officers or whatever? Yeah. So that the municipal, yeah. So from the district office, that's the director of education, they can move to the MCE, districts, and then find out how best we can help. So the counselor will write through the head will also help so that it gets to the director of education, that the district or the municipal one, then it will also get to the MCE so that we know what to do. And this one, we will do this as a counselor with the help of the social service person in the district office. But the social officers also there, they don't do their work. They even have to come down the schools and then find out the problems of the children and then table it. But they won't come. They always come when there is a problem. Somebody is on transfer. Director's mother is there. Director's father is dead. Then they are coming for money. Director is on transfer. Then they will come and then collect 10 CDs from all the teachers. That one, they will come down to do that. But they won't come down to find out the needs, the financial needs, the assistance that these children they need. And then at your level also, you may come, maybe you can't pay your fees and those kind of things. All that we can do is to help you so that you can apply for the VC scholarship and then see how best we can also push it through so that you get it. So that at the end, you will be able to finish your school. So one thing, though we have a lot of characteristics, but it's not that you should be generous. That's anything at all, then you start giving out. Then it means counselors will be poor in no time. But those who are in need, we do help them. We do help them a lot. We do help them. Some people will come with their problems and it's like, eesh, so are such people in the world. So it's like you need to help them. You need to help them. So the work is for those who have that empathy, Yes, to help others. So it's a helping relationship. And you are not supposed to do any harm to anybody. So you need to at least help such people. So with the financial, as a teacher, you need to talk to your head, then director, the MCE, and then see how best you can solve this problem. If it is the university too, when you come, we also look at how best through our director, how best we can help you through maybe some VC scholarship or whatever, so that you can also be able to finish your education. Thank you so much, Maxwell. I'm sure I've been able to answer your question for you. Can't follow-up service or counseling be impeded by financial constraints because the professional might be financially handicapped? Yes, I think, Pepra, I said so. When I was talking about the problems of follow-up, I said lack of what? Financial support. There are nothing is in the system to help you. Nothing is in there. So you have to do all these things with your own money. So if the money, you don't have the money, then it means truly the whole thing is going to be something else. All that we've talked about will be in vain. But at least we get time to call some friends on the phone, and it's like, hey Charlie, this, that, hey. So use that time to call your students and then find out how they are faring. Although it's not easy, but we should try as much as possible to do that, because it can even make the counselor handicapped, as you thought, financially handicapped, as you thought said. But still, we need to try. Thank you so much, Dominic. It's not all that clear, but I will try and then see how best we can solve this. How can a counselor for a dropout student know or locate the new counselor for this dropout student who has changed location? Please, do we have deaf and dumb counselors? This is from Benjamin, level 300 social studies department. So Ben, for the first one, it's not all that clear, but how can a counselor for a dropout student know or locate the new counselor of this dropout student? Let me put it this way. For instance, how will you know the location of these dropout students? We are in a community with them. So if as a counselor, if you care to get more information about your client, don't worry, don't hesitate. Just talk to their peers. They know everything about them. Don't go to the parents. Don't worry yourself going to the parents or the teachers. They don't know. Go to their peers. They will help you. Wherever that dropout girl or boy is, they will help you to know that particular place. So just talk to the peers. You will know where they are. Then your second question. Please, do we have deaf and then dumb counselors? We don't have. All counselors, I'm sure, we are not deaf and then we are not dumb. But we can counsel the deaf and then the dumb. Actually, what we are saying is that we must ensure confidentiality. So with this, it means that whatever that we are discussing is not between the counselor and then the deaf, but we have to get the one who will be doing the sign language for us as well. So here we are going to be three. And with the three, our confidentiality still remains the same. So here, since we are in a group and we ensure confidentiality, the same thing will also happen as we are with three. So this one is not between me and then the deaf and dumb, but it's among what the three. Which is what? The deaf or the dumb, the counselor, and then the one who is going to do the sign language for us. So we have counselors. But the fact that we have counselors for them doesn't mean the counselors are also what? Deaf and dumb. We normally look for people to come and then do the sign language for us. So as they do the sign language, I will talk, and then they will do the sign language to the deaf. The deaf will also do the sign language. Then the sign language interpreter will also say it so that I will know what the person is trying to say, and then see how best I can help that person out. So we do have, but it's not that the counselors are deaf or dumb. Thank you so much, Benjamin. Thank you, madam, for today's lecture. This is from Benjamin Sam. I think, Ben, your last message that we talked about. So thank you so much, Ben, too. And I also thank you very much for listening. And next week, too, we will come your way with revision. So with revision, you'll be meeting Mr. Mwakon, Mr. Ziga, Mr. Ofori-Dankwa. And then they will come, and then all that we've done from first week, I think second week up to today, and then maybe tomorrow we'll meet. They will come next week, and then you'll talk about everything. So I'm very, very grateful to you, my dear listeners. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.